I can barely hear.
Good afternoon, okay. Richland College. How's the hearing now, Nick?
Great.
welcome to another edition of the Philosophy Club Radio Show Hour. I'm your faculty sponsor. I'm your host, Professor Manzi. And it was supposed to be kind of just me, but all these people barged in. I guess we'll have to accommodate them.
And the co-host.
And the co-host. Well, Ro was the one I wanted out most of all, but here he is. So, yeah, typically what we do is we'll go around and introduce everybody. But first, a couple things. You're listening to KDUX Web Radio, broadcast live from Richland College in Dallas, Texas. We are the voice of Richland College. Views expressed on this show are our own, unless otherwise stated, and do not reflect the opinion of KDUX Web Radio, Richland College, or the DCCCD. So, yeah, we got people are filing in. It's party time here at KDUX. It's a quack takeover.
KDUX?
Thunder Duck Dynasty. Okay, guys. Anna, good to see you. All right, so, let's go around and just everybody introduce themselves. Some people are spectating. Others are going to participate, and maybe we could swap in and out, depending on how comfortable they feel. Yeah, take it all the way from the back. We'll begin with Ashley.
I'm Ashley. No. I'm Ashley. I'm a philosophy student and philosophy club member.
I'm Nikolai, philosophy club member and honors of ethics.
I'm Raul, co-host of the show and member of the Honor Society at here Academy here in Richland.
I'm Dara, and I'm a student in philosophy ethics.
I'm Anna, and I'm a student in philosophy.
I'm Theo, and I just barged in. So I'm a student in philosophy as well.
I'm Cliff, and I'm a mechanical engineering student, philosophy enthusiast, and it's real crowded in here. I actually kind of like it. It's cool. It's real cool.
That makes one of us.
Oh, I'm Johnny, and I'm a student at philosophy too.
Welcome.
Hi, I'm Elvis. I'm a philosophy student with the one and only Professor Manzi.
Thank you. Shout out.
Doing it for extra credit.
No extra credit. I lied to them all. I said they'd have extra credit. None of them will be having extra credit. Extra credit will be based on their performance in the show today. So anyway, guys, I'm glad everybody could be here. This is exciting. This is the last one of the semester, sadly. But we'll be back in the spring term. I'll say this though. The Philosophy Club Radio Show Hour, still not a good title, is an extension of the Philosophy Club. The Philosophy Club meets every Tuesday from 3 to 4 in room EO91. And we will be meeting next Tuesday. The topic will be philosophy itself. What is philosophy? What is its purpose, its function? And why should we study it, or should we at all? Why do I have a job? That's a question many people ask. Today's topic, however, again, extension from Tuesday's discussion, is respect. R-E-S-K-D-U-X. Respect. So I'll say this, as I do oftentimes, part of the Richland requack. Requack! Sorry. He nailed it. The requack is when we discuss some of the more salient talking points from Tuesday's discussion. Tuesday's discussion was great. It's crunch time, and you never know how many people are going to be able to attend these meetings, but we had another full crowd. And the issue of respect, I won't say hotly contested, because everybody seems on board with respect, but where respect comes from and why we should respect was a big issue. I guess before I get started, does anybody have any thoughts just in general they'd like to share on respect for a jumping off point? Why show respect? And what is respect? And what is its sources? What are its sources? There's 10 people in here and nobody has anything to say.
You only gave them like a millisecond, Mr. Manzi.
You should be thinking that quickly by now. Anyways.
I guess respect to be courteous. Give respect to the other person because you respect that you see that person and you acknowledge that person is there. You try to keep a equal level when you're trying to communicate with somebody. So then there's no feeling of intimidation or feeling that someone is belittling you just in a simple encounter.
Yeah, no, that's fascinating. And I should say this as well. Most of us just attended a Phi Theta Kappa event upstairs in Brazos Gallery, the focus of which was a roundtable discussion on individualism and collectivism. And I think issues of respect were coming up in that discussion, maybe not explicitly, but certainly an undertone, I would say. And so this idea that Nick has of respect is on the one hand sort of social convention and treating people in a particular way, I think is very much a part of it. I'm just wondering where we even came up with the idea of respect. Because a lot of people just assume, I want to say that respect has always been a thing, has always been around. And especially when people are disrespected to the point where you could even call it unjust, it arouses certain feelings of maybe anger or at the very least indignity. But why ever show respect? And why do we show respect to some people or some things more than others, or some ideas more than others?
I was in there for the... Was somebody else saying something? Because I'll wait. Okay. Well, I was in there...
Very respectful.
Yeah. I was in there during the session with Professor Ewing of World Religion Studies.
Shout out.
Professor Moore of the Government School, and Professor Manzi of Philosophy
Big
Studies.
Shout
out. Yeah. And how respect came up was how collectives and individuals can respect each other. Not the question. It wasn't ever the question of why or why we respect each other, but how. But I'm saying respect. Not now. No, not now.
So disrespectful.
Triggered.
So if I may interrupt, if I may be so bold. Getting back to this idea of respect and the sources of respect. A big contention in the philosophy club was that respect is rooted in, you know, before I alluded to this idea of feeling indignant when one feels disrespected, that respect is rooted in something like dignity. Now, we studied Kant, and he will argue that human dignity is something intrinsic. It's something that you don't have to prove is there. It's already there. And for that reason, you owe it. It's your duty. It's your obligation to exhibit respect towards your fellow man and woman. But the problem came when people were trying to extend the same kind of respect to things like the environment or animals. And, you know, are there gradations of respect to show to certain things? Or is respect some sort of universal, one size fits all? So, for example, let's see how it's reflected in the laws. If I run over a dog, did I disrespect him?
Well, you didn't do it intentionally. I would hope.
Let's assume
I would
did.
Hope. If you did, then it's pretty disrespectful.
Especially your dog.
My dog.
I was joking.
That's where he went.
I think it's more than
I thought he ran away. Go ahead.
No, I'm just saying the dog part.
Absolutely. That was disrespectful in the name of Fluffy that he decided to say that he ran over my dog.
That is adorable.
Thank you. It would... I'm still.
Well, because it's like this, guys. A dog has no idea what respect is. Respect right. seems to be a human idea. And so, how can you show respect to something who has no conception of it, and more so, wouldn't necessarily expect it? Right? Please dive in, buddy.
One question, but a dog shows loyalty, right? Isn't that a form of respect for his owner?
How so?
I'm like...
I think you're right, but...
He's trustworthy, kind of, you know what I'm saying?
Faithful.
Faithful, trustworthy, all those, you know, good parts.
It knows when it's being treated wrong.
Oh, how so?
If you kick a dog, it's,
Well, because here's the thing, is that, my dog is extremely loyal, extremely faithful to me, to the point where he just... I feel like he truly believes in his heart that I am never doing anything to work against him. And so if I picked him up and threw him against the wall 15 times, I think he'd think we were playing a new game. A game that he might not like, but he wouldn't think I'm disrespecting him or I'm trying to abuse him. I think he would just be like, oh, daddy thinks this is fun.
That's morbid.
Yeah, that's very morbid. I would say I guess the intelligence of your dog would differ as well, because what if you picked me up and threw me against the wall 15 times, be like, hey, come on, can you chill out a minute? Like, I don't know. I don't like this game you think we're playing, but your dog may think it's cool, but I don't think it's cool. So,
interesting. Who wants to pick up Nick and throw him against the discussion ultimately boiled down to this. As human beings who are capable of grasping what it is to respect someone or something, and again, this respects for ideas, the notion of religious liberty came up in the discussion today, and that you can say is a matter of respect. You have to respect that other people worship different gods or adhere to different cultural customs, and even if they're not your own, and even if you disagree with them on an intellectual or ideological level, you ought to respect their freedom to worship the way they please. Why should I not want to enforce my own ideas, my own agenda on others, especially if I feel like I've got a better argument than you? And, you know, I feel that way most times. Let me hear it. She's thinking.
Like, I would say it's worth respecting people because, you know, eventually, like, okay, let's say you have a certain view that you believe should dominate most of society. You can't dominate, your idea can't dominate most of society without people. So to some degree, you need to respect others to even, like, I don't know, influence people with your own ideas, I guess. So there's no way around it.
I think that's an interesting point. So in other words, respect, because this was the other thing, is respect earned or is it assumed?
It seems like on certain aspects, depending on the way you feel about yourself, I feel that there's people that assume it, and then there's people that, did you say expect it? Or did you say earn it?
Yeah.
I mean, it all depends. I think we can go around the table and say, well, what do you think? I believe it kind of is earned, but we talk about this in ethics, that there's actually two sides of the table in that. You stated that. There's four sides. But
Anna, get in the camera. Move to your left.
Who?
Anna.
What? Anna, move to your left.
Oh.
Your other left.
My other left.
Okay. I believe it's earned. Because if you...
No, Andy, you can sit up.
Let's think
of... I want you in the camera.
Oh, I'm...
Otherwise, you're just a random voice.
Let's think of this as if we have a simple conversation with somebody. Like, let's say, take him for example. If I talk to him, it's his universe versus my universe. In a sense, he has his own reality, I have my own reality. But if we earn the respect, and it's don't make a smart joke.
You can't see Raul's face, but he looks very uncomfortable.
So if we have different realities and we've experienced different things, and we earn and we have a mutual understanding that respect is earned, it would go a lot smoother. There wouldn't be a battle. There wouldn't be assuming. There wouldn't be he disrespected me, or he respected me.
That's a really interesting way to put it, and it ties back into the last comment as well. This idea of, on the one hand, you can't expect to be treated with respect if you aren't at least showing people you're capable of respecting others.
Right.
I think that's a very important quality, but again, how does something like respect become earned for those who have no idea what respect is? And so, I mean, for example, the environment. Why do we respect the environment? How does the environment doesn't respect us, it would seem. So why should we respect it?
Can I say? All right. So,
get up against the mic. Like that's, you really do have to.
Eat that mic.
All right. Regarding the environment, I would say that if we start, you know, cutting all the trees or, you know, soil erosion and everything could affect the entire environment of that area. Like, we can have droughts, we can have famines, or we can have, like, global warming and all the things we're seeing right now. So
if we don't respect the environment, we would also enable our own extinction, right?
Mm. Right, existence. Yeah.
Because
yeah.
the environment provides for us.
Right.
Ooh, okay.
So
we respect it.
Yeah, we respect it. No, we don't respect it, but we have to respect it, bro.
I respect it.
What's that?
We respect it by regarding it. So.
Hmm. Well, is that a play on words? Gardening? Regarding it? Anybody?
Regard.
Hey. Yeah. So the other, yeah, no, I think that's right. And the idea that on some level we know that we need the environment to continue to live as a species compels us to shepherd it to some degree. But, you know, do you need, because how far can you stretch it? Do we need insects? Do we need dogs? Why should we respect them? Is it because they, you know, show us affection, and so we want to take care of them? Is that a respect issue? Do animals have rights?
They do, I believe.
Should they?
Yeah, absolutely.
Why?
Animals have rights.
Why should we respect them?
Oh, whoa. Good question.
Well, I enjoy the dog. I enjoy the cats because they make me not feel alone. That's one thing. There you go.
Okay. You don't have to raise your hand, Ro.
What if, for example, a cow? What if you respect the cow, but you still kill the cow and eat the cow?
That's respect.
Different kind of respect. Yeah.
It tastes real good, you know?
Hinduism respects the cow. They don't eat cows.
What's her name? The vegetarian girl? On the club?
Oh man, I thought she was in here for a second when somebody said that.
Arguing vegetarianism. Yeah.
She was.
That's Leslie.
She was saying.
Shout out, Leslie.
Lindsay.
Lindsay.
I'm going to be in trouble.
She was saying that. She was saying that all life is some kind of value, and I was saying that we eat animals because that's how humans are designed.
Right.
Yes. It's built into our biology to take protein and turn it into. I seriously forget all my high school biology, but
turn it into muscle. We burn it.
Yeah. It doesn't make sense to exclude meat from the diet.
Because my question would be that I think
you know the pescatarian, right, Cliff?
What's that?
Nobody knows. Only eats fish as meat.
Are you serious?
Sorry, buddy.
Yeah.
Why am I apologizing?
It's the same thing. They're pets.
You should apologize.
They're animals.
What's the difference? Like, how do you say that fish don't feel pain? How do you know that?
Because they don't have a nervous system.
And yeah, thank you for coming to my defense. And
I mean, really?
But there is new evidence that plants feel pain.
Anyhow, pushing forward.
No, they seriously do. They respond by releasing irritable chemicals whenever bugs start eating a leaf.
Really?
Seriously.
Wow.
You gotta change his diet.
Okay, because this is it. I think that, and this was Lindsay's point, is that the reason why you ought to respect animals is because, much like humans, they experience pain.
Right.
And we can relate to that. Like, I wouldn't want to inflict pain upon my fellow man or myself, ideally. So then why should I do it to this poor little defenseless, arguably, creature?
So, yeah, my question comes, what if you treat the animal well? Like, you know those cows that they feed them the best type of food? They give
Kobe
them beer.
Beef.
And then they kill them, like, peacefully.
Yeah.
Aren't you respecting the animal?
In
a way.
Instead
of torturing it, you're giving it like a quick kill. And
yeah, and you know, okay, it's I guess a more humane way to kill
it.
Yeah.
Humane.
But here's that gives rise to another example that came up in the club is kosher meals. So for example, if you're Jewish, you eat pork. But the pork has to be prepared in a certain way, and they would argue that it's showing respect not only to the religion but to the animal itself. So it has to be slaughtered, and its cleanliness, its purity is maintained throughout the killing process. And so eating kosher food is an extension of their religion, mm-hmm. their beliefs, and eating food that is not kosher is, well, it's immoral. It's against the law. And so respecting the animal, at least in terms of how you put her down and prepare her, there's something, again, human and arguably divine about that. And that seemed to be Ashley's point too, this idea that we emphasize respect for the earth, arguably for, well, I guess that we could put it in the form of a question. Do we respect nature? Do we respect the environment because we know we need it and so therefore selfish reasons? Or do you respect, you know, a beautiful environment because of its beauty and its purity in a sense? So you have people who are chaining themselves to trees, preserving national forests and parks out of respect for nature, allegedly.
I have an answer, but does anybody else?
On why to respect the environment?
That's why I should have responded to every question at the roundtable discussion today.
Okay, what I'm saying is, in the meeting Tuesday, I y'all heard me saying that we only respect others and other life just as a matter of self-preservation or as a matter of natural order or something. You know what I mean? Because if we want to be respected, we must respect. And that's something else that I'm just now getting around to thinking about. Okay. is that all sentient life is the golden rule, as Professor Ewing said in the Phi Theta Kappa session. Mm. Is that we want to treat others as we want to be treated. And so, consequentially, sentient life must be treated as respectfully as possible, because we are a member of such things, and we would not want to be cruelly and cruelly treated or executed, for even if it is part of a natural process for even if humans were part of an extraterrestrial's food chain, you know what I mean?
We
would not want to be undergoing such a lot of pain. That's why what do you call them, where they kill the cows?
Slaughterhouses.
I almost said killing fields.
But that's why at slaughterhouses I think they should be putting nails through the brain. I think that's how it's done. I don't know.
Yeah, I heard that too.
I've seen some practices that were really inhumane. But
yeah, it's most definitely. Like,
one question then: what's the human way, like the humane way to kill a cow?
Less pain as possible.
The most painless way to do it is put something through the brain to cut the. And fish not having nervous system. Where the hell do you get that from?
that is
Wikipedia.
Huh?
He said Wikipedia.
Fish don't have a nervous system.
Ooh,
do they? I mean, fact check, Joe. Get on it.
They would have to have a nervous system because they have to feel that. How do you breathe? How do you?
We have a
fish don't breathe.
Gills and stuff like
they that. Breathe. Okay,
we're a little out of our elements here.
Yeah.
This isn't the biology club. So let's get to something else, because we're 25 minutes deep here, and there's something else I want to consider. Is we delineated two different kinds of respect. Respect that is fear-based, and respect that is more, promotional of creativity and the human spirit. And so a lot of people want to argue that, well, respect comes from fear. You're afraid that the environment will give up on you, so you need to preserve it. You're afraid that others won't treat you with respect if you don't treat them with respect. You're afraid you'll go to jail if you don't respect the laws. So things like this. And there were countless examples that came up where, fear is kind of the basis for respect. But, I mean, and then somebody else came up with the idea, why do you respect a baby? A baby can't... You should be afraid of a baby. Ah, because it would die?
What? It's a new life.
Oh, it's a new life.
I never said it... What? What do you mean respect a baby?
You're killing babies?
No.
You're a baby killer?
No, that's not. That's not. I eat them.
Is it a modest proposal?
Anyways, back to whenever you said the law. You don't have to respect the law. You have to obey the law.
Ooh, interesting distinction. Go on.
So even though you may not respect it, you still gotta obey it. So
thank you.
Same thing goes for
your professor,
the baby. The baby's a new life.
Okay.
It's supposed to be cute and cuddly. Awesome. You're supposed to like it because it's new life. It's a species. It is what it is. It's a baby. You're supposed to raise a baby.
But why would you not respect a baby?
Because it cries, it keeps you up at night.
Inconvenience. What's it doing for me? It's just a leech.
It's none but a parasite. No, I'm just kidding. Believe that. Just kidding. I like babies.
Don't have kids.
Views expressed are hers only. Yeah, okay. No, because you're getting at something really interesting there, Nick, is this idea of, well, if you respecting life is not the same thing as respect based out of fear. It's respecting, again, the intrinsic value of something. So life, by its very definition, is deserving or worthy of respect. It doesn't have to be earned. Respecting the life of a baby doesn't have to earn your respect. It already has it automatically. And you can see how that's different from, you know, your boss having to earn your respect, or vice versa, trying to earn the respect of your boss. What kinds of things do you suppose, and this goes out to everybody, are inherently worthy of respect? I mean, so life might be one of them, human life. But anything else? Religious liberty, maybe, as it came up?
We...
Yeah.
You go ahead.
No, I was pointing at you.
Come on.
Alright, I'm saying...
Dead air, guys, come on.
We respect only what we place value in.
Yes.
Because if we don't respect our society, then if we respect our society, if we place value in our society, sure, then we will place value in we will respect those those in the government. That's the, for example, we got to respect their titles. And such. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That came up too. That's a good point, Cliff. Is this idea of respecting the title versus maybe respecting the individual who serves in that title?
Right.
Yeah. So I mean, what do you guys make of that?
I think it's perfectly clear.
Okay. All right. Well, that'll do it, guys.
Let's bounce.
And so, just to flesh that out a bit more, and again, you can consider the Bo Bergdahl case.
There you go. I was about to bring it up because you have to, in the military, we say this a lot. If you're a non-commissioned officer, if you're in charge of troops, you'll always say, you know, you don't have to respect me as a person, but you have to respect my rank. That's basically the same thing with saluting officers, same thing with the customs and courtesies, that you'll show your superiors. You don't have to respect him as a person, but you have to respect him as a rank. So you may not like him outside of the job, but unfortunately, you're a subordinate. You're not a leader. But when you become a leader, then you can change your ways to where you think that you can be more respected or earn that respect.
Okay, yeah, that's interesting. So yeah, I suppose combining the two points, the title is commanding of respect. You know, no pun intended.
Basically, do as you're told.
Yeah, obedience, adherence to the chain of commands. And yet the person himself or herself might have to earn your respect on a more personal, individual level. And you could say the same thing for, I think, rights. So what is that? I disagree with what you say, but I'll defend to the death your right to say it. I might not respect your position, your ideas, your points of view, but I respect the freedom you are entitled to have when expressing them. But then, of course, that gets into stickier situations. Like, well, at what point do you lose respect? At what point do you are no longer worthy of respect? And if you do lose respect, can you ever get it back fully? Yeah.
I guess.
Sounds more like trustworthiness as well.
Yeah, and maybe you're right. Maybe respect and trust are more closely tied together than we really initially gave thought to it. Well, okay, then what is the difference between trust and trust and philosophy? The difference between trust and respect. Can you respect somebody you don't trust?
Yeah.
Well, Bo, what do you think Bo thought?
I don't know.
Yeah, like, for example, let's say I robbed the bank, and everybody knows I did, but they can't arrest me.
I can believe it.
So people would be, whoa, I admire that.
I didn't think of that.
That's a good idea. Yeah, it's a good example. So like you respect the talent, you respect the courage,
the hustle.
I respect your hustle role. But
yeah, thank you.
but yeah, nonetheless, you wouldn't place your trust in this guy unless, of course, you wanted somebody to help you rob a bank.
But then what about if somebody like steals your, like you leave your money on the table, you go to the bathroom, you come back, it's gone, and the only one person in the room, and you ask him, you know, where's my money? He said, I don't know. But then you see him go buy a bag of chips. I mean, it may not be. It's just he's just stole your money.
No, I hear, and yeah, you have
I'm
reason
not saying
to believe
that it's him. Yeah, 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 it, yeah. That's an accusation, but that's beyond. Okay, my example was not very good, but my point is if he stole something from you, would you respect him in that sense?
Yeah.
That means that you can't trust him, and he stole something from you, and I don't respect him because he's. Took from me. There's no value. There's no.
Yeah, you might say that if you're gonna rob somebody like that in such a flagrant fashion, that you lack self-respect. Because how could you respect yourself if you're just stealing your friend's money to buy chips or? Yeah. So let me ask you this notion of self-respect. How does it tie into notions of respect as they're fear-based versus, I guess, inherent based?
If you don't respect yourself, how can you respect someone else?
Yeah, that's a real good question. Yeah, Anna, your thoughts?
Because if you're not, I guess, acting according with your beliefs, you're eventually not going to respect yourself. And then it's going to, I guess, maybe make you, like, cynical of things.
But wouldn't you, like, if you don't have any self-respect, wouldn't you respect a person because they have what you want?
You would either respect them for they have what you want, or you'd respect them because they embody the things that you embody, which aren't necessarily the best things if you have no self-respect.
Yeah, okay, so that's a couple things going on there. Yeah, I think getting back to the idea of respect as talent. So you can respect somebody for, I guess, having something that you would want to, you know, typically I think... Well, I guess it goes both ways, really. You could respect or admire somebody's virtues. Oh, he's really courageous. I respect that. Or he told the truth. He has integrity. I respect that. I wish I had that myself. And use it as a catalyst. Or on the other hand, you could say, well, yeah, you know, respect recognizes respect. We respect the same things. We have the same ideals. You seem to get it, quote unquote. And so I respect you. I look at you as somebody who is worthy of my respect, deserving of my respect. But having said that, certainly people can lose respect for people, especially I think in Ashley's case, if they no longer seem to embody the same sort of ideals that you thought you shared together. Can you lose respect for yourself, and can you regain it? Well, you have to have it to lose it, right?
I really don't think that the definition of respect changes between between inside or outside of the self, the image of self.
Okay.
I think you can lose respect, especially because if we define respect as a human being's intrinsic worth, and I think if somebody wants to, like, you know, they're having thoughts of suicide, they've lost sight of their, like, you know, their intrinsic worth. So yeah, you can lose respect for yourself.
Yeah. Okay. And there again, we see respect tied to value.
What are some examples of disrespect to yourself, like not having self-respect? What are some examples?
Yeah. Cutting.
Yeah.
Cutting yourself is okay.
No. Cutting a knife. No. I don't. Everybody stop, because.
Collaborate. Listen.
No, because.
Nobody.
Self. On the very serious subjects of suicide and self harm, self respect hardly ever comes into the equation.
Right, that's what I was thinking.
Well, why do you guys say that?
If you don't value yourself, then you're not going to take care of yourself. And I would say that eating a healthy diet, maybe working out, being involved with other individuals would amount to self-respect in a sense.
I sincerely disagree. All of that comes from just a feeling of despair. Some irrationality, and y'all gotta listen to what Mr. Moore said yesterday. He put it down. But I'm really upset with y'all saying that somebody's resorting to self-harm is just a matter of lack of self-respect. I really wish y'all would quit with that.
Oh, I don't think everybody. I don't think people are saying that exclusively. But I think maybe you should rethink the importance of respect with regards to how one sees oneself, because certainly there's way more to it than that. Of course, despair and stuff comes into play. But I think at the end of the day, what they're saying is certainly worthy of consideration, should not be so easily dismissed, Cliff. This idea of respecting yourself and valuing yourself is directly tied into how you treat yourself. Okay. And so you could see people who, they may not realize that they don't value themselves, but outsiders can say, well, look at how you're treating yourself. Just like you can look at somebody on the job, and if the guy's doing a poor job, you could say, oh, he doesn't respect the job. And then sometimes the boss will sit down and say, well, you must not respect yourself, because if you did, you would take your responsibility seriously. And so to this idea of, yeah, when you try to cultivate healthy habits and when you try to become the kind of person who is worthy of respect, like a model for maybe your younger brothers or sisters or something, you're going to do so in such a way where you're taking care of yourself as well as treating others kindly in such a way where, okay, this is a person who clearly values other people. And I wonder how it's possible to value other people and not yourself. And I guess here's one possibility. I have a strong value for, you could say, giving to others, and I'll just give and give and give and give and give. And then you leave no room for yourself.
Didn't Gandhi do that?
Well, and Mother Teresa came up today in the discussion as some sort of saints. Who did so out of joy. But it seems like to really respect oneself, one would have to, on some level, be willing to take time out for oneself. That there's something in terms of self-care that is a requisite part of respecting others. Because you wouldn't want, and again, going back to the golden rule, you wouldn't want somebody to give himself or herself 100% of the time to the point of self-exhaustion. You would say, no, take care of yourself. You mean just as much as the people who you're helping. It's not as though you mean less to them, and you're there for your time and your sacrifices. No. I mean, okay, so we still got 20 minutes. Good. I want to get back to this idea of respect with regards to, not simply because I don't want respect to remain in, like, the human realm. Like, I really, because this came up a lot in Philosophy Club, and I want to make sure we give it some attention. This idea of respecting things like, ideas, or respecting not just the environment and animals in terms of rights, but respecting what it is to, want to take care. And again, I'm thinking of this in light also of the individualism and collectivism thing. If you are in a society whose values, you know, and imagine this, whose values are starkly in contrast to your own, then it's a question of whether or not the possibility is there for you to show respect to others. And that includes whether or not this society values the environment, the society values certain, beekeeping strategies, to use one example. What'd you say?
No.
Are we still requacking? Is this still part of the requack?
No.
Can we move down to the segment?
What do you mean by beekeeping? Because my uncle does that.
Really?
Yeah.
Did you watch the movie?
My cousin.
Are you serious?
Yeah, he opened.
What is the point of beekeeping?
No, not the point. But what does he mean?
Well, in the context.
I understand the point completely. Okay. Bees are awesome.
Yeah.
But
I agree.
And that's just. I was just more, you know, bees came to mind because I'm just looking at my students and thinking of, you know, the highest grades they can hope of getting.
Well, if we come if we come together, we can make that honey to give to you.
And that sweet nectar.
Anyways.
Catch a buzz.
We're getting off topic.
Don't get stung.
Catch a buzz.
Anyways.
You're the queen bee, aren't you?
Okay. This show's not coming back.
More bee puns.
I guess I only brought up that example for the following reason. you can, I was trying to think of like an oddball example that, that you can imagine not every society or even every person would respect. Some sort of hobby that, that you say, well, oh, this is valuable. Beekeeping as a hobby, bees in general, the, I don't know why we're talking about bees. The role they serve in nature, you, we've come to the point where we can understand it and respect it. But imagine if you knew all that and then you lived in a place where they killed bees for fun.
Like here?
Like here.
What?
Oh.
I wouldn't say they do it for fun. I would say they do it out of fear.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, I've seen people do horrible things for fun.
To bees?
Anything.
To be or
yeah.
not to be?
Yeah, be couldn't, and bees
couldn't
included.
Couldn't they be considered as like a continuation of the human respect?
How so? Perhaps.
For example, your dog.
My dog.
People are not gonna kill your dog. Well, firstly, because they don't kill dogs. But second, because it's your dog, and you own the dog, and why you shouldn't throw eggs at someone's house? It's their house. You're gonna pay the consequences.
Yeah. Because yeah.
That could go.
Flashback.
That could go to like I don't know, like a forest. You shouldn't.
Yeah, and so
I shouldn't burn the forest.
I think what you're saying is this. Yeah. Respect might be something that. And again, getting back to this idea of gradations, you can continually, I guess, apply it to varying degrees of success or failure to anything. If you have an idea of just what respect is, then you can understand why certain things just not necessarily command it, but are worthy of it. And so I'm letting you say, yeah, don't egg a house because, well, you respect the law and you don't want to commit vandalism. But also don't you know, egg a house because you respect the fact that it's a house. And it's you wouldn't want your house egged either. Again, getting back to the golden rule. And similarly, that only goes so far. So you can say, well, I respect nature and the environment, so we shouldn't chop down the tree. It's not because you imagine yourself as a tree and you want to be chopped down.
No.
But you respect it for different reasons. You respect right. it because, well, again, getting back to the baby example, I respect life, and I respect, you know, or perhaps you could say I respect potential and beauty, and I respect the purity of some environments and why that should be preserved for a number of reasons. And so, yeah, I guess to your point, Ro, respect is something that can kind of be widely applied for different reasons, but all boiling down to this idea of, well, sometimes... Well, I guess let me ask you this. Again, I put this in the form of a question. With regards to respect, should you... Are there better reasons for respecting than others? I guess we'll put it that way. So is respect out of fear a better reason than respect out of, say, intrinsic value?
I'd say intrinsic value is a better reason to respect something.
Yeah.
Just to sustain it, so that we, and if it's an important part of life, then we would want to keep it around, wouldn't we?
I think so.
I agree because I think respect, like if you fear something, you can only fear it for so long, or that can only be a last, that it can't be a long lasting motivation. So I agree with that. Respect out of fear, in the long run isn't. I don't know. It's not
sustainable.
It doesn't suffice.
Yeah.
So would that go back to like John Rawls and his like the basing something off of fear would be like a rational judgment.
Yeah. Interesting. Well, we've all read Rawls here. What do y'all think?
Triggered.
Anybody write on Rawls for the final or the midterm?
No.
Okay. So yeah. Yeah. Ashley, I think so. I think that is in fact the case. And what's more so, this idea of respect being tied to values opposed to fear, as being somewhat a more authentic version of respect. Yeah. Because at the same time, if you respect something out of fear, you're kind of always waiting for the opportunity to remove the object of fear. And so it's not so. It's like a forced respect. As opposed to, say, respecting somebody's talent, you respect the value of that talent. So, I mean, and again, this could be subjective. If you derive pleasure from, I don't know, baseball, and you value people who are good at baseball, and then, and so when you see somebody who's especially talented, you have a lot of respect for that talent or ability. But if you don't care about baseball, you might not really show them the same amount of respect because the value isn't there. You might respect them as a person, but it's like, yeah, I play baseball, and you're like, okay, whatever. I don't know anything about that game. But then there are things that are universally worthy of respect. And I think this is what I really wanted to get at here. And I think those are what are tied to the rights that we have. So the respect to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Again, life seems always worthy of respect. Liberty always seems worthy of respect. And one's happiness and the freedom to pursue it would seem worthy of respect on all levels. Right to a fair trial. Right to justice being served. I mean, that's worthy of respect. But is there anything that's the absolute pinnacle of respect? Something that, I don't know the answer to this, something whose value you cannot question and therefore is always going to be, again, demanding that you respect and acknowledge it?
God in God. Christianity.
I was waiting for somebody to say that.
Yeah, it's coming.
Well, God. Well, why? Because, again,
Well, you said who doesn't question, and you hear people a lot that are like, why are you even questioning the word of God?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You hear that?
Interesting.
You can hear it.
Wait, what's your name again?
Professor Manzi.
Him, in the blue shirt.
Oh, Nick.
Nikolai.
Nikolai. Is that something you, is that a question, or?
What do you mean? I'm a Buddhist, so you can say whatever you want.
I forgot.
Well, I'll just really step in and say this quickly. This idea of the divine, because this is kind of what I think people would go to, is this notion of something that is pure divinity, that is supposedly, in the case of the Christian God, omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent, something that is all powerful. I think on the one hand, it combines the two forms of respect we've been talking about. So people fear God. Or fear burning in hell for all eternity. That wasn't a cuss, by the way. That was an actual place. Trigger. Allegedly. And so there's the respect out of fear. But then there's also the respect for, you know, if you respect knowledge and wisdom, of course you're going to respect the source thereof. If you respect life and happiness, arguably you respect the source thereof. The problem, of course, is that not everybody believes in the same God, and some people don't believe in God. And so what needs to be respected, I would say, is, again, getting back to this notion of religious liberty that was discussed in the Phi Theta Kappa roundtable. This notion of respecting the freedom you have to value things, even if not everybody values them. I think the freedom to value might be the most worthwhile thing to respect.
Yeah.
What do you guys think?
Would that be respect or tolerance, though?
Ooh, good question. What's the link? Yeah, so we got 5 minutes left here. I got the five-minute mark from our producer here, Jack Fletcher. So let's consider that. What is the link between respect and tolerance? What is tolerance?
Like you tolerate the people around you, but you may not.
Does it have a negative connotation or positive connotation?
It has a neutral connotation.
I think it has a negative.
How so?
Tolerating it sounds good, but like just having to do it, it's not necessarily, you know, it's a good thing, but it's not necessarily the easiest thing. So I think because it requires a lot of effort, that's why I don't think it necessarily has a positive connotation to it. That's why I think it has a negative connotation to it. So yeah.
Okay, yeah. So you can imagine, like, you know, tolerating your mother's poor cooking. We've come full circle, Raul. I discussed that.
It's like I tolerate the people at the train station. I tolerate the people at the store. It's ability to just keep it neutral.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean that I have to respect the people around them unless they're in my universe. Unless I see them and someone accidentally drops something, then I'll pick it up for them. That's almost respect.
Oh, okay.
If I pick something up, yeah, it's courtesy.
Yeah.
So that's almost a form of respect. I respect that you're here. I acknowledge that you're here. I'm not turning a blind eye.
Okay, interesting. Yeah, and so would you say respect then has a positive connotation, or is it also a neutral connotation?
What?
Oh, I think respect has a positive connotation because I can disrespect you as well. That's a negative connotation.
Okay.
There's no distolerance or...
Or intolerance.
Intolerance. Yeah, there is intolerance.
You made up a word.
And so, yeah, it's that happens a lot in philosophy.
Same
for
here,
better
man.
For worse. And so, yeah, it's this idea of, I think, at the end of the day, we can say this about respect. And I guess we'll end with this. Of all the things worth respecting, and respect being positive, and you know, respect being a sign that you are plugged in, so to speak, to those around you, to your fellow man, and to your environment, and you respect, you know, civil discourse like we have in the Philosophy Club, which meets every Tuesday in EO 91 from 3 to 4 p.m. At the end of the day, you should just respect the fact that I'm in your life. All right, guys. This has been a great semester in the Philosophy Club Radio Hour. I really want to thank my guests. Great to have you guys here. Nice to have some of the newbies here sitting in. And of course, those who come semi-regularly, thanks to you guys. I hope you guys have a great rest of your semester and year. And good luck on finals, everyone.
Especially Mr. Mandy's class.
Yeah. Good luck.
can we plug?
Oh yeah, sure, definitely. Yeah, if you guys have anything you want to plug, any events coming up or anything like that, you want to rain praise down upon me, by all means. Cliff, do you want to plug something?
Yeah. I got something. I encourage everybody to join up, or at least engage with the Richland Black Students Association. We have a website at richlandblackstudents.org, and I've opened a chat room at discordapp.com.
Wow, look at
that. It's at rlchat.madsci.net, as in madscience.net. Okay. It's rlchat.madsci.net, and there's several places, topics going on in there. I'm the only one in there right now, but I'm waiting for it to be a huge conversation hub, announcements and all that for Richland College. Something I'm trying to get going.
Yeah, because you had because you plugged philosophy events in the past through that as well, I believe, right?
Yep.
Yeah, no, I think there needs to be something like that where things that are pertinent can be promoted in ways that maybe are more readily accessible to students. I think that's a good thing. Also, I should plug this as well. If you want to see our video podcast here. The archives, so to speak, go to richlandstudentmedia.com. You'll see all sorts of interesting things happening around Richland, not just the Philosophy Club Radio Hour, but a lot of things. And it's definitely worth checking out. And again, it's we are very pleased to make use of the studio and you know, KDUX Web Radio. You know, not a lot of colleges have something like this, especially in the district, and it's a wonderful thing for students to get together and talk about philosophy and shoot the breeze, so to speak. And sometimes it gets pretty real, but other times it's a little silly. And I think most of the time we strike a nice harmony. Now, I do want to plug one more thing as well. actually, no, I'm sorry. Does anybody else have anything to plug?
Did we get extra credit?
Were you going to say something?
Oh, my trusty co-host. I've lost so much respect for you. Anna, do you want to say something?
Me? No, I'm good.
Okay, guys. So I want to plug the following. If you go to the art gallery in the library, right now there are artistic works based on philosophy, specifically existentialism and maybe Nietzsche in particular. So if you're, you know, during finals week, you might find yourself in the library. If you need to take a little break from studying, check out the artwork there. It's pretty impressive stuff. It's this collaboration between the philosophy program and the art department. Really neat. It's, again, very impressive work. So I want to give one final shout out to that. This was great, guys. Register for classes. I am teaching ethics, honors ethics, and introduction to philosophy in the spring. I guess that'll be my final plug. Totally self-serving. This whole radio hour, I suppose, was really just one giant plug for my classes. Anyways, and again, I look forward to the Philosophy Club. We will meet one last time this semester in EO 91, Tuesday, 3 to 4, topic of which is philosophy itself. And to the large number of people here, thanks for coming out. I know it's late in the semester, it's late in the week, it's late on a Friday, and so I'm glad to have you guys here. It's been an absolute pleasure serving the Richland K Ducks community, and wish you all well. As I know, 8 episodes deep, I still don't know how to hit stop on the recording. Take care, y'all. Quack, quack.
Yeah. Stay righteous, y'all.